So how in the world could the disciples understand Jesus' behavior? They had sacrificed everything to follow him. Peter had left his home with his wife. The other disciples had left their businesses. They had traveled with him, and I'm sure behind all of that was the belief that Jesus was going to become the new king, that they were included on the inside of a powerful new government that was going to be for the deliverance of all of Israel. And yet Jesus just didn't match their expectations. How many times I've thought God is going to do something great here, and then the great thing God did was not at all what I expected. It was something completely different. What do we do when it looks like everything is falling apart and we don't see any possibility for getting through this in one piece? The disciples have now walked with Jesus for 3 years. They have taken financial hits. Their wives and their families have been very concerned. Other members of the family had to come forward and support them. I don't know if out of the purse Jesus helped the families. The scriptures don't tell us that, but I know that these men loved each other and they loved Jesus. And they were bound up in this messianic belief that the kingdom of God was going to be established now. And so everything was on the line. They were all in for Jesus. And now he's going back to Jerusalem. And he's telling them that he's going to die there. How can the Messiah, how can God die? They all believed that Jesus was God. How can God die? It contradicted everything that they understood theologically. How do they successfully put their lives back together after this havoc? They'd learned to trust Jesus. But then he began to say some things that were even more disturbing. In John, the 11th chapter, he begins walking with them through the final days to believe on him because of the miraculous signs. Then they come to chapter 11 where Lazarus dies. And he's raised back to life in a very public demonstration. And the disciples all understood that this was a demonstration of the power that they had seen Jesus exercise so many times in private. But now it was very, very public, right next to Jerusalem. Everybody saw it. And yet everybody's talking, and the disciples, all 12 of them, are talking about Jesus is saying he's going to die. Then we come to chapter 13. He washes their feet. He humbles himself. Peter says, "You're going to wash my feet? Never." They knew he was Messiah. They knew he was God. God doesn't get down on his knees and wash feet. That's for the servant to do. They still didn't understand that they were called to be servants and that Jesus modeled servanthood. And then these terrifying words are spoken. Verse 21. After he'd said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and he testified, "I tell you the truth. One of you is going to betray me." So now the tight-knit group of 12 disciples plus Jesus, 13 in total, that were closer than brothers, they were as close as human men can become. They'd spent 3 years walking and ministering and talking and learning, sacrificing together, going through all kinds of hardship, all for the cause of this great messianic kingdom that was to be established. And now Jesus has told them that he's going to die. Then he tells them that one of them will betray him. They all look at each other. Is it you? Is it me? Who is it? Is there a traitor in our midst? In the midst of all of this struggle, and they're asking Jesus at that Last Supper, he tells them who it is, but they don't understand, and Judas leaves. It's very informative that the book of John in chapter 13, verse 30, as soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night. Darkness had settled on these dear men who were believers in Jesus, who had raised the dead, who had healed the sick, who'd walked in revival power. These men who were sold out for Jesus are now being splintered by a betrayer, one of their own. And then he tells them the last straw. After all of this, I'll be resurrected. And after the resurrection, I'm going to leave you. And you can't come where I'm going. You'll come later, but you can't come now. And then he makes this amazing statement in verse 34. This is John, the 13th chapter, verse 34. A new command I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. So they've been told that Jesus is going to leave. They've been told that Jesus is going to die. They've been told that there's a betrayer in the midst of them. And Jesus then says, now love each other. Well, I'm sure they didn't want to love each other. I'm sure they wanted to kill each other. Look what we've been through. Look what's happened. I'm sure anger rose up in their hearts and despair. This is all worth nothing. Everything is being destroyed. It's being thrown away. Well, I have to tell you today how many times in my walk with Jesus it's looked like everything was being destroyed in my life. It's like everything was crashing. There wasn't the money to do the work of the gospel. There wasn't the money to take care of me personally. My wife dies. Everything is coming apart. People are angry because my wife has died, and now they're saying in the church, it's obvious that we can't trust Pastor because he prayed and he said his wife would be healed, and she's died. Betrayers emerge amidst the brethren and the sisters of Jesus. And he says, look, everybody knows you're in trouble. So love each other. Be gentle with each other. Be kind to each other. I have everything under control. Well, Peter, he gets right up in Jesus' face and says, I want to follow you now. I'm not going to betray you. In fact, I'll lay my life down for you, Jesus. And Jesus answers in verse 38, will you really lay down your life for me? I tell you the truth, before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times. In other words, before the morning hour, Peter, you're going to turn against me and deny me 3 times. He's saying you can't even trust your own heart. I hope you caught that. Don't be fooled into thinking that you can trust your heart. Your heart is deceptive. Your heart will lie. Your heart will betray. You know, I'm just so humbled before God today because I see in the national news all of the wickedness of our leaders that's being exposed, the sexual uncleanness, the lies. Men are losing their lives. Benghazi was an utter travesty as our president allowed four Americans to die because of his agenda, a hidden agenda. We don't know what to believe in America anymore. I look at all of this outside of me, and then I have to turn my gaze at myself and say, but by the grace of God, there too am I. I recognize the capacity of my heart to be unfaithful to my wife. I praise God I was not unfaithful to her. I praise God by His grace and His mercy. I have nothing to be ashamed of in what happened between my precious wife and myself before her death. I have no regrets. She's with Jesus now, and it's clean. But I recognize the ability in my heart to be absolutely immoral, to lie, to cheat, to steal. I recognize the capacity in my soul for untold wickedness, for absolute despicable behavior. But by the grace of God, that's who I would be today. The disciples are having to look very honestly at their hearts. They don't like what they see. Jesus is the master of Reelsville. He doesn't play games. He says the word of God straight and true like an arrow. It must have pierced Peter's heart. And then after he betrayed Jesus, he went out and wept, utterly heartbroken because he knew his capacity for wickedness, to lie and to cheat, to be selfish, to grab what he wanted for himself. He wanted the kingdom of God for himself. He wanted Jesus for himself. Breaks my heart. Do you recognize your capacity for evil? Do you recognize how quickly you can turn against the Most High God? It has to humble our hearts. And then we come to chapter 14, verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Don't let your hearts be troubled that I'm leaving and that everything is coming apart at the seams and that I'm going to die and that there's a betrayer among you. Don't let your heart be troubled. What? What? Everything's coming apart in your life. You don't have the money. You don't have time. You don't know where to turn. Everything seems to be going upside down. Don't let your heart be troubled. There's no way through the wall that I face. There's no possibility of redemption. I've done everything I can do, and I can't do anymore, and I'm exhausted, and it's hopeless, and I might as well give up. Don't let your heart be troubled, Jesus said. Don't let your heart be troubled. And then it says, trust in God. The real translation is not really trust. It's from the word pistis, meaning faith. And it's also in the imperative, which means faith in God. You faith in God. Or that word pistis in the Greek, it means trust, but it also means to give credence to. It means to put your confidence in. It means to rest your weight upon. It means to cast everything in, to hold nothing back. It says you put everything, put all your problems, put everything you're facing, put it in God's hands. And then he says, trust also in me. He's saying, again, imperative. Pistis is the word again. You faith in me. He's saying, no matter what your circumstances look like, no matter how hard it seems to be, no matter how beat up you are, no matter how tired and exhausted you are from struggling against whatever you're facing, he's saying, you put everything in your heart in me. Put your faith in me. Now, verse 2 is not a very comforting verse for me, if I could be that blunt. It would be much better for me if he would say, put your confidence in me and I'll work everything out just the way you want it. But that's not what he says. That's not what he says. He says, put every bit of your confidence in me. Put your credence in me. Put your trust in me. Put your faith in me. Don't hold anything back from me. Because in my Father's house are many rooms or mansions or places. The literal word is place. In my Father's house are many places. Well, where's my place? My place is in a townhouse where I repose at night. I call that my home. He's saying, in heaven, in my Father's house, are many homes. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you. I'm going to prepare your home. So don't worry about what you're facing here, because it's all small potatoes. Don't worry about the conflict you're engaged in here. Just trust me, and I'm going to carry you through, and I'm going to give you a place with me, and you're going to be where I am. Now that's comforting to my heart. No, everything's not going to work out here just the way I want it, perhaps. But it is going to all work out for the good. For those who love the Lord, that was his promise. All things work together for good for those who love the Lord. So no matter how bad it is now, no matter how difficult the struggle, Jesus is disciplining me as a son. He's taken me into the woodshed time after time. I have suffered all kind of shame and reproach for the name of Jesus Christ. It's okay. I've worn myself out doing radio. I've worn myself out pastoring and trying to tell people about Jesus, and in the end it seems that there's very little result. It's all right. I have a place for you. I have your home. I'm preparing it in my Father's house. Now you know the context of this social description of his Father's house. We don't understand it very well, but the Jewish people understood very well what Jesus was saying, because in that day, when a man wanted to marry a woman, he would go and propose with his father and family, and there would be a meeting and there would be an agreement. And he would offer that prospective bride a wine cup, like the communion cup. And if she accepted that cup, it sealed the proposal for marriage that they were engaged and would be married. And from that day forward, she walked as a married woman. She did not look at another man, and she did not entertain another man's suggestion that they be married. As far as she was concerned, she was married. But now what did the bridegroom do? He went home with his daddy, and they built a place onto the family home where he could bring his bride, often taking up to a year to do the whole building and to furnish it and to make it ready for the bride. And then the bridegroom would come, and the maidens would go meet him and escort him to the wedding supper. And they would have a great banquet at the Father's house. I'm looking forward to that banquet at the Father's house. My father, my earthly father, used to say to me so many times, Ray, the greatest thing in my life will be the day I get to sit down at the table with Jesus and with all of his saints. And I'd say, Daddy, how long is that table going to be? He'd say, Son, I don't know, but it's going to be a big table that we sit down at. And the food will be such that you've never tasted before in your life. It will be a king's feast. And we will sit and eat together with our Lord. I'd see such a look come over his face, a face of such gentle strength, a face of such absolute courage and confidence and trust in Jesus. I know it's true. I know it's true. We are going to be seated at that great table of the Lord. And we're going to give thanksgiving unto the Lord for his kindness and his mercy. He says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Is your heart troubled today? You probably have good reason to have a troubled heart. You may be suffering physically. You may be suffering emotionally. You may have a money problem. You may have a family issue. You may have a husband in jail. You may have a wife who is rebelling against you. Don't let your heart be troubled. You may have children that are in full rebellion and wickedness, playing with drugs. You may have a job that's ending. You may be unemployed today. Don't let your heart be troubled. These are but momentary struggles. These are but momentary burdens that we bear. Roll them over to Jesus. He said, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Roll your burden over to Jesus. He has a place for you. You can trust him. He loves you. At the conclusion of our worship service this past Sunday at the National Prayer Chapel, I had the music team come up and we sang a cappella. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Our phone number in studio today is 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. You're welcome to call. If you're burdened today and you just need someone to pray with you, call me and I'll pray with you. I'm Ray Greenlee. This is Pilgrim's Progress, where we talk about this journey in very practical terms that we're making from that city of destruction as we escape that city and we take that journey on the straight and narrow path until we finally reach the celestial city. Many of you are traveling with me. I praise God for your walking fellowship with me. Thank you for joining me on Pilgrim's Progress. You're welcome to worship with the National Prayer Chapel on Tuesday evening. I call it an old-fashioned John Wesley class meeting where we get down to the nitty-gritty. We ask questions and we share. You're welcome to be a part with us this evening. We meet at 7:30 at All Saints Church. It's an Anglican church, All Saints Church, located on Gideon Drive in Woodbridge, Virginia. We're right next to the Hilton Memorial Chapel on Gideon Drive. It's a brand new facility. It's beautiful. I invite you to come. We'll start praying at 6:30. We'll pray for an hour. And at 7:30, we'll begin with some informal praise and worship. And then we'll dive right into the work of the evening. This evening will not be an exception. We're expecting the Holy Spirit to meet us and the glory of Jesus to come down in this meeting. You're also welcome to join us on a Sunday. Our service is at 12:30 p.m. You're welcome to come. 12:30 p.m., drive around to the back part of the church. There's a ground-level entrance. It says the lower lobby. Double glass doors, just come right on in and you'll find us on your left. All Saints Anglican Church or All Saints Church, you're welcome to come and fellowship with us. Again, our number in studio is 877-534-0780. Now, part of the process for not letting our hearts be troubled is the reading of the scriptures, praying, fasting, and the giving of our gifts to Jesus. I want to thank each of you who has contributed. We now are at $1,725 toward the month of November for radio. All of that has been given by you who listen, and I praise God. I trust him in what he's doing with this radio broadcast. That's giving is a part of what causes us not to be troubled in our hearts. Fasting one day a week, having only water to drink, but fasting before the Lord. That's another important part of this journey of keeping our hearts clean before God. The reading of Scripture. Spending several hours a day, if possible, just soaking in the Word of God. It means you may have to turn off the television, because if you're watching the television, you will not be able to read the Word of God. It'll just put you to sleep. Your mind will be seared. Even if you're watching the History Channel, it won't work. You're going to have to turn it off. And then prayer. Consecrated, earnest, sincere prayer, where we finally get honest with God and we wait on him for the answers. I'm going to read another story from Guy Bevington about prayer. This dear man was a traveling holiness evangelist. And he ministered in southern Ohio and Kentucky, Tennessee, in the turn of the century. He was holding a meeting, and as he concluded that evangelistic series of meetings, he was invited to come to a new location and to start another series of meetings. But as was his habit, he went to the woods to settle this new call. It was in the late fall, and it was chilly outside. And the Lord showed him a large tree that had fallen, that was an empty tree in the middle. It was an empty log. And to get out of the wind, he crawled up in that big empty log in order to pray. He says, God met me there, and he told me to go. So I went. I preached 3 nights, and then I was abruptly notified I could not preach anymore in that schoolhouse. Knowing that God had told me to go, I again went out to the woods, and I found a hollow log, and I crawled inside to pray. Now, we don't have these kinds of things happen much anymore, but in that day it was not unusual for a pastor to go to a church at the invitation of that congregation to preach a series of meetings, and if they weren't pleased with his preaching, they just lock him out. That happened at Azusa Street. It's happened many times. There was real conflict around the turn of the century between different Christians because the holiness preachers were preaching such a strong message and they were confronting sin so powerfully that people got very angry and upset, even as they do, and some of you have, at the message that I've brought on this radio. You get very angry and you turn the radio off for a while, and then after a while you come back and turn it on because you want to know what this crazy preacher's saying today. Well, that's what happened to him. He was thrown out. He was locked out of the building. He couldn't preach there anymore. And you would think he would just go away. But he couldn't do that because God told him to go there and to preach the gospel. So he goes up in the woods. He finds another hollow log and he crawls in it. And he prays. For 5 days, he doesn't have anything to eat. And then a most puzzling thing began to happen. He said, I began to get hungry, a sign that usually meant my fasting and prayer was over. Yet I knew I did not have the victory that I was seeking. A decision had to be made, and in short order. I chose to remain there praying until I heard my answer from heaven or died right inside that log. Now, I've done that on quite a number of times when I finally just laid down in my prayer closet and I've said, Lord, I'm going to stay here and I'm going to pray until either you answer or I die. And after some days, the Lord has always answered me. And he's given me clear direction. That's why I'm here on this radio. He told me to come. He gave me a foundation of faith to stand on, and so I'm here proclaiming to you the gospel of Jesus Christ. He says, my hunger kept increasing, and I felt weaker and weaker. These had generally been the evidence that a fast was either called off by God or I had gotten through. I bring up this point to caution the reader that there is a danger of getting in a rut for God's work. And God never works in a rut. He always does something new. About 24 hours after I began telling the Lord that I was very hungry but not yet satisfied, I was now 6 days into my watch. My log was somewhat smaller than I generally found, and so I was a bit cramped, and I occasionally stretched as best I could by extending my arms over my head. This time, as I stretched, I touched something with my hand. I gathered up several small objects in my hand and found I was holding 6 acorns. Now, I'd never been fond of acorns, but I felt impressed to eat these. Now, if you don't know about acorns, some acorns you can't eat because it has such strong tannic acid in it. Particularly the black acorn that has a sharp pointed leaf. You can't eat those without processing them and getting that tannic acid out. But a red oak has a white meat in it, and they're delicious. You crack that white oak acorn open, and they're delicious to eat. I had never been fond of acorns, but I felt impressed to eat these. And oh my, these acorns tasted wonderful. So obviously he had the red acorns. The squirrels were told by God which acorn to choose. They were very fresh. I could not imagine how they'd gotten into that log. Also, I wondered how long they'd been there since I'd not felt them at all the other times that I had stretched my hands out in exactly the same way. I asked the Lord these questions and waited for his answer. After eating the acorns, I felt refreshed. After laying there in prayer all night, I found 6 more acorns when I stretched out my hand the next morning. I carefully felt as far as I could, but only found the 6 of them. I found 6 acorns in that hollow log 3 times a day for the next 4 days. The acorns appeared right on schedule until I finally prayed the matter through. It took me 10 days in all to get quiet enough before God to get his answer. As the appearance of those acorns was still quite a curiosity to me, on the last day of my watch, I crawled from the log and left my shoes at the entrance as a pretense that I was still inside. I moved some distance away to a tree, and I concealed myself. Within a short while, 6 large gray squirrels appeared. Each one jumped up on the log and dropped his acorn down a knothole, and then disappeared back into the underbrush. My, what a wonderful God! Thou hast been feeding me through these 6 squirrels. I wept for joy to realize he was so mindful of me that he had these small animals faithfully toiling right on schedule every day to meet my needs. I cried out in delight, "Elijah isn't the only one who is fed by your animals, Father." I was once again humbled by my amazing relationship with this mighty God. I have wished so many times that I could always live feeling as humble as I felt at that time. I actually crawled back into my log, and after another few hours, I got out and I looked down at the schoolhouse, and I saw several men and women down on their knees praying just outside of that schoolhouse that I'd been put out of 10 days before. Now, they did not know I was still nearby, so I started down the hill toward them. The men who had put me out of his home and the schoolhouse looked up and saw me and began to rush toward me. He was bareheaded and looked completely wild-eyed and reckless. I was not sure what his intentions were, but I held steady in the faith that this was all in order. As we met, he shouted, "Oh, brother, please pray for us. I'm so glad to see you. Pray for us. I've been in hell for these past 10 days. So we knelt down right there, and he prayed as earnestly as I've ever heard any man pray. We stayed on our knees pleading his case for the next 2 hours. He finally prayed through in fine shape and then begged me to come into his home again, promising to open the schoolhouse back up that very night. This is an old-timer. I'm reading this story to you to try to say to you, look, it's going to take time to get to God. If it took this humble man 10 days to get God's will regarding a meeting that he was holding, how long is it going to take you in all of your American sophistication? I've been praying that some of you would just feel like you were in hell, that the conviction would be so heavy on your heart that you'd have to turn away from your sin and come running to the National Prayer Chapel to weep and pray, and to get right with God. I suspect you won't be able to get right with God in most churches that most people go to, because probably the pastor's not right with God either, and he'd be embarrassed if you started getting right with God and started getting really honest about your sin. You know, I've found that we like to belittle our sin and not make much of it. We don't mind making something big of somebody else's sin, but our sin, we like to hide that. We like to cover it and pretend it's not a big deal at all. Oh, my brother, my sister, all sin is a free choice, It's a decision we make, and it's a big deal. It'll keep us out of heaven. It'll cause the Lord to cast us into hell. This is no self-improvement deal. You can't work on overcoming your sin. It's an amputation deal. You just have to, by the power of the blood, cut it off and say, it's done. I'm not going there anymore. I renounce it in the name of Jesus. I'm going to walk clean in the Spirit. But it requires some conviction before you'll do that. And then it requires getting on your face before God. And it may take quite a few hours for some of you. Maybe some days for some of you. Maybe some weeks for some of you. To finally come through and say, Lord, okay, I'll get honest with you now. This is what I've lied about. This is what I've stolen. This is my sexual uncleanness. This is who I really am, God. What would happen if you really told God who you are? If you didn't play any games with anybody? You just confessed how angry you've been, how bitter you are, how hurt you are, how disappointed you are, how unfaithful you've been. I've been praying, oh God, bring this conviction. Don't let us continue with our heads lifted proudly up before your throne. Oh God, don't let us continue this. Bring us to an end of ourselves. Let us see the reality of our condition. Don't let us continue walking in pride before you, but Lord God, do with us the same thing you did with the disciples. Tell us the truth about what our sin is before you. Tell us about our betrayal of you, Jesus. Which of you listening to this broadcast has not betrayed Jesus? I have. And I have wept over it. Have you wept over your betrayal of Jesus? Some of you have betrayed him so many times and in so many ways, you say, Pastor, I don't even know what you're talking about. Right. Yes, you do. You know in your heart whether you're cold toward the Lord. You know in your heart whether you're lying to people about who you really are. You know in your heart who you are. Don't play games. You know what your ambitions are. You know where you like to invest your time and energy. Don't play games with God today. There's no time. There's no time to play games with God. He's coming again. His judgments are about to be poured out on this nation. It's time for us to rise up and say, Jesus, Son of the living God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. How do you stand with Jesus? Are you clean? Are you washed? Have you been restored by his grace? Are you still one of those Christians walking around saying, I'm saved, but walking in sin? I've had men actually say to me, Pastor, I'm saved. And then to confess they're having an affair. Oh, but they're saved. Only to let me know finally, when they get real, that they're embezzling money at work. That they're cheating on their taxes. That they've been unfaithful before God. That they've not paid their tithe. They've withheld from God, and yet they're saved. Oh, there's no time for these kinds of games. My brother, my sister, stop it. Get real. Get honest. Tell him the truth. Oh, how are we going to walk the final journey across that Jordan River if we're not clean before God? The wind, the waves, they'll sweep us away into hell.
You see it. Before you go into the celestial city, you must cross through the Jordan River. And if you have not confessed your sin, if you are not clean before God, if you're still walking in your wickedness, the waves and the water will sweep you away and you will be lost. You'll never make it across that river with sin in your heart. Are you clean before God today? Have you entered in the prayer closet like this, dear brother? Even for your own salvation, have you entered in like this, dear brother, for the salvation of others? I'll be honest with you. The answer is found on your knees before God. When you finally have the courage to be honest with Him about who you are and what you want, and you ask Him to change you. You ask Him by His precious blood to wash you and make you clean. You ask Him by His precious blood to restore you to the heavenly host. He is gracious and long-suffering. He is filled with mercy and compassion. He is slow to anger. He is God. And if you don't repent, you will be shut off for eternity from His presence. Is your sin worth being shut out from heaven for eternity? Is that money that you so lust after, is it worth being shut out of eternity and the presence of Jesus forever? The lies that you've been telling, the anger that's been in your heart, the bitterness that's risen up, is it worth eternity? Isn't it time for us just to start to tell the truth about who we are, about what our condition is? That's all God is asking us to do. Tell Him the truth. Confess it honestly. Tell Him who we are, what our sin is, what we have done. Confess it with tears and brokenness. It's the only way to escape going to hell. But oh, when we do, what peace rules in our heart. What joy fills our soul. What love and what glory washes over us. The burden is finally cut from our backs. He says the meetings resumed. We had a blessed time there for the next 3 weeks. Many sought and found God, all because I stayed in that hollow log in spite of the confusing aspects of my intense physical hunger. Oh, how I wish that folks were not so ready to give up so quickly. They're all too willing to fold up and give in to whatever Satan says. That man allowed Satan to drive me out of his home and then out of the schoolhouse. If I had done as many easily would have, given up and gone off to a more inviting place, where would those souls have landed? And I ask you, have you given up? Have you let Satan lie to your heart? Have you allowed Satan to tell you things that simply aren't true? Has he told you it's hopeless? Has he told you that God will never answer your cry? Has he told you that prayer is useless? That it's like my prayers don't go up even to the ceiling, they fall to the ground. If that's true, I'm telling you why. If your prayers don't pierce the ceiling and they fall to the ground in front of you, it's because you're lying in your prayer. It's lying to God. So get honest with God and your prayers will arise immediately through the ceiling into the heavenly host. And they will be heard by the Almighty God. Don't give up. Don't turn aside. Don't turn away. Don't fill your heart with the lust of the world. Don't fill your heart with foolishness, but turn to Jesus. He'll meet you. He loves you. He's calling after you, or you wouldn't even be listening to this broadcast. You'd have turned it off a long time ago. Please hear me today and believe me when I say, out of my own walk, out of my own experience, out of the truth of scriptures, and out of the truth that this man is speaking, this holiness evangelist, God loves you. God loves you. And his peace passes all understanding. And if you will confess your sins, he will forgive you. Now let me pray with you. Almighty God, King of kings and Lord of lords, I ask, would you have mercy on my dear brother and sister? Would you hear the cry of their heart? For some, Lord, would you increase the conviction until they feel like they're in hell? Would you increase the conviction and break the casualness of heart? For, Lord, they can be casual now, but they will not be casual as they're being cast into the fiery furnace. Then you said they would be weeping with gnashing of teeth. Lord, I'm asking that the weeping could happen now, with confession of sin, with getting right with you, with receiving the precious blood you shed on Calvary to wash them clean, to make them whole. Lord, I pray for every person listening. I'm asking that you meet them where they are right now, that you call after them with your gentle and caring voice, that you cause them to get on their face before you and begin to cry aloud, to take whatever time it's going to take to deal with pride and arrogance and hardness of heart. Lord, show them the truth about their heart. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. God bless you, my brother, my sister. I'll talk with you soon. His glory with great joy, with great joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory. Jesus.